deaden the fundamental in the middle. Don't hold it so you change the timbre, the pitch of the drum. You don't want to do that. Just deaden the fundamental. And now this one's down. Okay. This one's down. So the reason I started over here is because I'm going to do them both. Even all those are, they all, I don't know exactly what note that is, but they are all even. So the drum is not fighting itself from one side to the other, and the fundamentals should be pretty clean. I don't know if you can hear that or not, but the fundamental is beautiful. It's just real straight ahead. So then, you have to do that with the snares off, and then once you're here, and see, we don't have any muffling on that drum at all. It's a beautiful bing. It doesn't go bing, 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 bing. None of that. You can't have that, especially on a recording. That would drive Ronnie Millsap out the wall. He'd run screaming out of the room. That's really pretty good. This drum has had one night of playing on it, so the head is nice and seated. The drum sounds really fat. It sounds really good. And the great thing about these drums, I think I did it on one of my other Memphis drum shop things, is on my drum and on other drums that have dual strainers, you can really adjust the... Let me hit it lightly so it's not so much... Hear the white noise? And there's times you want that. You want the drum to be a little fatter with a little more white noise. Even more. I remember walking into A&M studio and sat down at Jeff Porcaro's set one day. I was in A&M B doing Lionel Richie. And he was in A doing somebody else, I can't remember. But I listened to his snare drum, and there was so much gizz on the snare drum. And I went, boy, I was doing mine really tight. Except for the next session, and I made it gizz like Jeff Porcaro's. Anyway, more choices. There's more choices in a drum set than any other instrument. There's stick changes, technique. You can, if you want to play a little differently, put your hand back over and play traditional and lay back into the set. I've done songs before recording where I put on sunglasses to change my attitude. I've even put a cigarette in my mouth to change my attitude, and I don't smoke. You got to get in character for every song. So Bryce, good to talk to you. That's a tuning lesson. Thanks for writing. I hope the family's good. Hope the girl's good.
Yeah, another question. This is a little bit further away than Texas. This is from Rome, Italy, Alessandro. And he wants to know, Mr. Leim, how do you cope with a situation where you are recording exactly in time with the click and the other band members are somewhat off the click? How do you disguise that time gap?
You fire everybody but yourself. No, you can't do that. Sorry. It's very difficult. That is a very difficult situation, and guys that are not used to playing to a click, they don't really realize how small that pocket window is. It's really a small pocket. You can fluctuate a little bit with a fill or something, and then let it settle back down again. But the best thing to get them to do is I have a line that I say when we're recording, and if somebody's not with a click, which has become a kind of a line in Nashville now, is, can everybody hear the click? Just kind of a nice question. Can everybody hear the click?
So it's kind of like when they want to say, thank you. That means quit.
Yeah. But it's hard to get players that don't hear it to hear it. Because if they heard it in the first place, they would already have fixed it. So that's a difficult one. But with practice, they can learn to do it. But they have to practice to a metronome.
Lots of questions, Paul. We're going to to get to at least some of them. Here's one that actually came in this morning.
Okay.
This is from the Cymbalholic site. It says, I love Paul's work. There's much to learn from this guy. But I'd be curious to see what are some of his go-to ride cymbals and hi-hats for most of his session work and how he goes about determining, you know, those for a particular track.
I've gotten to... as I've played harder and harder, because rock music, especially country music, has turned more into rock music than what we always knew as traditional country music. Even DJ Fontana on some of the Elvis records, this is a typical Buddy Harmon thing, if I can find the right weapon here. Buddy Harmon, the old typical Nashville sound was a brush and a stick. There's even a real cute trick with that you can do. And Buddy used to do that. So I had a point and I lost the point. What was the question again? Sorry.
Well, it was about now you're playing so much louder.
Yes.
Yes.
Playing so much louder. I used to use 14-inch hi-hats, but I've gone to using a 13-inch dark crisp. They still have the they have a nice chunk to them, and they have the high end to them. But they're not as loud. So recording with when I have a microphone right here on the set, I don't know if you can see that or not. You can't see that. But if there's a microphone anywhere in proximity of the hi-hats, the snare drum mic's going to pick up some of that. Now with Pro Tools, we can go in and separate out the snare drums. But for a live situation, for me, it's better to give the engineer more control of the hi-hat. If he wants more hi-hat, let him turn up more hi-hat. And I'm tending to start now to back off the hi-hat, because I've heard tracks where the hi-hat's so loud that it bothers me. So I've gone to smaller hi-hats again on these. Now, when it comes to ride cymbals, this dark full ride, I've had a 20-inch Paiste dark full ride for a long time. They don't make the 20 anymore. Now they make a 21. And the dark full, the bell, and also the dark full, and the dry series. There's a lot of ride cymbals. When you start playing on the bell, the cymbal starts getting louder and louder and louder and louder and louder, and all of a sudden you have this huge wash over the kit. With the dark fulls and the dry rides, you don't have that. If you're playing a bell, you're tanging the hump. It's a very funny term anyway. Little Nashville humor there. But the roar doesn't get louder on the cymbal. The cymbal stays concise, tight, and right there. So I believe, did we hit his question, Jim?
Yes, you got it.
Great.
Well, we got another one here. This is from Bruce Crump, who he says is the original drummer for Molly Hatchet. And he says, I'm totally in sync with your comment about 80s drummers making noise today in country music. I need to be one of those drummers. Help a brother and a Memphis native out.
Help a brother and a Memphis native out.
Yeah.
Well, we sure enjoy your town, Memphis native.
Hey, speaking of natives, do you know where Snook, Texas is?
Snook, Texas?
Yeah, S-N-O-O-K, Snook, Texas.
Snook, I don't know where Snook
is.
Well,
Jimmy Rogers is in Snook, Texas, and he wants to know, are all your Yamaha drums, are they birch or are they maple?
This set that I just ordered for the Elvis show, they are birch toms, maple kicks. I don't know if you can go, Jim... There's no better authority on the planet than Jim Pettit from Memphis Drum Shop about if that's something you have to order, or Jim, do you ever order? Is that a special order?
Not necessarily, no. We can order birch toms with maple kick.
You cannot do that?
Yes.
We probably started that about 20 years ago. I discovered that maple kicks just had more bottom end to them. The birch kicks didn't have they were round and nice, and if you're in a large venue, if you're in a 10,000-seater or a club, nobody in the club's going to know. Nobody in the 10,000-seater is going to know. You're going to know.
But those birch toms.
But the birch toms, to me, I used Recording Customs when I first went with Yamaha. in 1983 up till I went to the Phoenix kit probably 2 years ago, I used the same recording custom set on all the hits you heard at the beginning of this thing, all the Lionel Richie records, all of Peter Cetera records, all the Amy Grant records, all the Shania Twain records. I probably put Birch custom recording drums with the long lugs. I probably put those drums on 250 million records. And then 2 years ago, they came out with something that I couldn't believe, and that was the Phoenix. And the Phoenix, I thought I'd never change, and the Phoenix are amazing. Phoenix drums are unbelievably amazing. They have the richness of the Birch toms, but more tone center. How many plies are the toms of the Phoenix?
10. Some, I think
10, 10 ply. Yeah. The technology had always been thinner and thinner and thinner and thinner for Birch and Maple, but the Phoenix went thicker, very much like the sonars used to be. And so we were a little scared of them, but they figured out how to not make them
sound like this.
To me, sonars sound like this. They great for club gig, you know, quiet drums, but they just didn't make it for me for playing out rock and roll, that kind of stuff. So, so Birch toms. I ordered this set in Birch because the Phoenix are probably half again as much. They're very expensive, and although Yamaha takes care of me, it was not necessary for a live performance because of what I said earlier. In a 20,000 seater or in a club, nobody else is going to know the difference. And I love these drums. These drums. If you see anybody that was at our concert last night, it was unbelievable. They were like cannons out front. Okay.
Well, you just answered the next question.
Oh.
And this is not from Snook, Texas. It's from Norway.
Oh.
It's Arnie from Norway, and his question was, why Yamaha, Mr. Leim? But I guess you pretty much answered that.
Yeah. Well, first of all, they're the best drums in the world. They really are. Yamaha drums, they care. These drums are made at a place called Sakai Rhythm in Japan. It's a custom drum shop. It's as personal as if Jim had his technicians here making you a drum set. That's how, when you get a high-level Birch recording custom drum set, that's exactly what they are. They're custom drums. Am I not right,
exactly,
Jim?
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. They're just you won't get a bad shell. I've gotten bad shells from Slingerland. I've gotten horrible shells from Ludwig back when Ludwig went downhill. I'm sorry. I was a Ludwig guy. They just didn't care anymore. They just didn't care.
The story really impressed me in the Yamaha factory at Sakai was one guy, you know, if you have a professional Yamaha drum, snare drum, set, whatever, one guy buffed that shell. Not somebody, but this guy, he buffs every shell. And you know what he told me when I asked him about his job? He said he'd been there he's now 25 years. He said, yes, and every day I strive to do better.
Unbelievable. Isn't that unbelievable?
It's really humbling.
Yeah, it is really humbling. They have a tremendous work ethic. They want it to be perfect, and they show it. I mean, it shows up in their cars too, doesn't it? Anyway, they make great products. The second reason is, when I tour in Europe, I need a big footprint on the planet because I go everywhere. And a lot of times, the budgets just won't allow for a rocket cargo to fly this set to Oslo, Norway. I'll be in Oslo, by the way. I'll be in Norway again. I think I'll post it on my website when I'm going to be in Oslo. We'll be with the TCB band. Both Ronnie and I will be doing that tour together. That's a hoot to do for Ronnie and I to play at the same time. That's a lot of fun. A lot of rocking going on in that. But we'll be in Oslo first part of January with the TCB band, so please come by and see us. I just produced a girl from Oslo, by the way, Lisa Dillon, and we did a project on her. Love Oslo, love Norway, and it's cold in Buda, by the way. So Yamaha has a great footprint on the planet, and when I need a set in Europe, Vienna, I call my guys here at Yamaha. They call Wolfgang over there, I can't pronounce his last name, or I would. But Wolfgang, make sure we have exactly what we want. If I'm in England, I'm going to be in the north of England. They get a set together, and they send it to Blackpool, or they send it to Liverpool, or they have it ready. It's just such a big footprint. Great drums, great support. They're all over the planet. What else do you want?
And the same thing happened the last time you recorded in Memphis.
Oh yeah, exactly right. We were here doing a project. As a matter of fact, Norbert Putnam was producing an artist here, and the budget just didn't allow for me to have Jim bring the set over. It was probably, $500 or something like that. And so Yamaha supplied the kit and made the deal for me, and Jim was kind enough and gracious enough to bring me exactly what I wanted. I had this drum set. I mean, I didn't have two bass drums because I don't use two bass drums in the studio, but I had my drums. Jim made sure I had my drums. I tell you what, if you're ever in America, anywhere close to the South, Mid-South, you gotta come to Memphis Drum Shop. There's not any other place like it on the planet. You talk about people caring. You've never seen anything like this. I'm talking from floor to ceiling, as far as you can see, just drumsticks. Floor to ceiling, as far as you can see, cymbals. He's got a room of Paiste gongs. It's unimaginable. It's unimaginable. Every drum you can imagine in the world, antique drums, you got to come to Memphis Drum Shop. And that's not just because I'm here. It's the truth.
Okay, thanks, Paul. Daniel Crider, I guess it is, from Columbia, South Carolina. He says, it's kind of a deep question, but he says, from the lack of record sales to Pro Tools and drum replacement programs, the state of the music industry seems like it's all doom and gloom. Is there a chance for up-and-coming players to become a Paul Leim, like an A-list player? Or has the industry changed so drastically that an A-list career may not exist someday?
You know, there's talk among us that might be the case. But I also know that there was a talk among the wrecking crew that there would never be another wrecking crew. And Hal Blaine is absolutely my hero, and he knows it too. I actually wrote a piece that he cried at a dinner that I couldn't attend in his honor. And I've heard those guys say there'll never be another time like that. And we proved them wrong. In Nashville, we had a time like that. And yes, our record sales are down by 50%. When we were doing Shania Twain, we sold 50 million records on Shania Twain. Taylor Swift is every bit as big as Shania Twain was, and I think Taylor sold 15 million records. So I understand what you're saying, and it's hurt all of us. I didn't tour for 35 years. I've stayed in the studio all the time. But when my kids got grown and I didn't have the responsibility of being home and seeing them with their homework every night, I decided to start taking some tours and doing some things, and it's broadened my career, and I love that. But the opportunity to be in Los Angeles and work with John Williams in the morning doing Star Wars, and then doing Fall Guy, a TV show that afternoon, and that night being with Lionel Richie and Kenny Rogers, cutting Endless Love or something like that, I'm not sure that's going to happen anymore because of what you're saying. And it's all because of budgets. And once electronics and everything came in, you take a writer that we had, it's called 100% scoring in TV film. They couldn't take the music from 1 week and use it on a subsequent week. They had to re-record the music. It's called 100% scoring. And that's what kept the studios, the copyists, and everybody in business in Los Angeles. And that was from a TV film standpoint. There's so much to talk about. Anyway, but yes, it's hurt the cartridge companies, it's hurt the studios, it's hurt everybody. You just have to find a way around it. Be as great as you can be, and I assure you, if you're one of the top players in the country, you'll be heard, and you can make it.
Okay, Paul, here's a lot of questions on Paiste and your cymbal setup. I'm going to try to roll about five or six into one for you.
Okay.
This is from the Drum Forum. He says, please tell me a story on how your tastes and opinions have changed over the years with your cymbal selection and how it evolved. And And also, Rick Baker from North Carolina says, Paul, some people say that Paiste cymbals excel in the studio due to the fact that they tend to sit above the mix. And is this a part of your sound? And then here's a guy, Jim from Des Moines, Iowa, says, please describe your Paiste setup. So just, I guess, everything Paiste for you.
Okay, great. Yeah, the Paiste cymbals, when they first, the signature line, as a matter of fact, I had a 20-inch crash that had kind of a ringtone at the top of it. And one of the engineers, it had this real high ringtone. In analog equipment, you couldn't hear it back. But in digital equipment, especially the early digital equipment, the 32-track Mitsubishi, you could hear this way up high. And we found out it was that cymbal. And so there were some problems with the early Paistes doing stuff like that. Not the early Paistes like John Bonham used, but later on when the Signature series came out. So some of those are too bright for the studio. So let's take a 19-inch Signature Power Crash. I could never use a 19-inch Signature Power Crash in the studio. It would completely overwhelm the set. But if you're, if it's with Motley Crue and you're playing a 20,000-seater, that's a different story. But you got to remember that the mics are still right here. They're hearing everything. So what I've gone to is this is a 19-inch Dark Energy Crash, 19-inch. I love this cymbal. This is a great cymbal, 19-inch Dark Energy. This is an 18-inch Full Crash Signature. This is a 17-inch Dark Energy Crash. And many times I use a 17-inch 20 series crash here. I like a darker cymbal here because sometimes if I'm doing like on Rockstar on the tune that I played earlier, if I'm doing a real rockin' tune, instead of riding here, I might just full open ride over here. Like this one darker than this one, it still gives me a higher level to go to. So I tend to go bigger, smaller, smaller, and then the China over here. And I started using the China back when we did Hello, that one hit in Hello. Hello, in the solo in Hello. Anyway. Just another hit in music, but it, I love a, which one is this? This is the 18 thin. The 18 thin China is fantastic. I love this, but they also have, if you can find one or get them to make it, it's a 22, I shouldn't go there, should I? They don't make it anymore, sorry. It's called a rock China. Paiste used to make it, and if you'll write them, maybe they'll start making it again. It's this beautiful cymbal that comes down. It's a China, so it comes up, down, up, it like a reverse China, and then it goes back down again. It's shaped down, up, like a China, and then back down again, so the edges are down. It's called a rock China. It's fantastic. Ron Tutt had one, and I said, man, I've got to have that cymbal. Matter of fact, I took it off the stand, and I walked out of the room with it, and they couldn't find one, so Paiste actually got out the original master and made me one. So I, once again, see, these companies, Paiste, Yamaha just made, and I know they can't do it for everybody, but that's how much they care. They didn't have it, so they frickin' made it, okay? I mean, how much more can you care than that?
Okay, this is
try to get Zildjian to remake an old cymbal.
Okay. Okay.
Maybe they will. I don't know.
Right along there, Paul.
No, sorry.
Danny Freeman.
I shouldn't have said
from,
that. Sorry, that was ugly.
Alatha,
I don't work with
Kansas,
people.
Says, you have played on so many records and so much production. In the early days before you developed your reputation, what helped you get sessions more? Was it your work ethic and dependability, or simply knowing the right people, or the last session you played, or what was the combination?
Boy, you just named them all. That's all of those. I always had a statement, if I wasn't 30 minutes early, I was late. you have to be prepared. I mean, I take so much stuff. We don't have time to do it. That we're going to have to do another one of these maybe, because I think we're just about out of time. But I brought my electronic gear that I do loops with. A lot of the records we did, pop records we did back in the 80s. I had a stack of stuff, electronics I used. I used to program records. And then play on top of them. I'm sorry, I just blew your ears out. And now, like on a Kenny Chesney record, there's a on Somewhere With You, the tune that I just played. If you might or might not be familiar with, I've got a program going on in there on the Island Records on When the Sun Goes Down. All of the percussion on When the Sun Goes Down is the Multi 12. It's doing hand percussion. I can easily change, just quickly I'll hit this. It's about having equipment. It's about having the right attitude. My job is to make the producer look great. The producer's job is to make the artist look great. The artist's job is to sell a million records so the record label, so this, the artist's job is to sell a million records so they can go buy the house they want. The record label thinks that it's the artist's job to sell a million records so they can go find another Shania Twain. But the artist should go buy a nice house. But anyway, so it's all about choices. And the Multi 12, seriously, and I'm not trying to be a sales pitch person here, but the Multi 12 is a marvelous addition to your drum kit. You can do percussion on it. You can sometimes put a drum set on it, record a drum set, and then do another, and then play the drums over it. You need to have choices. When they say, hey, can you do a loop on this thing? You got to be able to do a loop. If they say, you know, I think this is a real light jazz thing, you got to be able to pull out some maybe wood sticks and change your technique and not play everything you played at the last time. If they want it rocking, you got to be able to have a cymbal that you can just frickin' slam on and open it up and make it sound like you're in Shea Stadium or something. So it's about choices. It's about great attitude. It's about being there. And it's also about self-respect. You have to get yourself to a point where you're prepared, because you have to be prepared. Before we do an Elvis concert, if I've been in this studio, matter of fact, this just happened. We just did a new Scotty McCreery Christmas record. He won American Idol last year. We did his record last year. We just did a Christmas record on Scotty McCreery before he goes back to school. And so I spent the whole day playing brushes. Well, there's for the gloves again. I'm prepared, because I know I'll get blisters if I go straight into playing Elvis. I'll get blisters because I play hard when I play a rock show, and so I'll rehearse. I'll run the Elvis show for 2 days ahead of time just to get myself in physical shape to be able to go on and make it look effortless. It's not effortless, but I try my best to make it look effortless. Don't ever let them see you blink.
But you know, Paul, all the things you just mentioned. I mean, I don't play on your level, but, you know, I play a lot of gigs around Memphis. I just played a rock gig the other day, last night. I got a Dixieland gig in the morning. I got a big band gig Sunday. So you got to have the different tools and all those things you just mentioned, and showing up early. And so I don't care if you're an A-list player in a studio, but if you're playing in the club down the street, what's the difference?
It's the same thing. I remember in Dallas there was when I was doing studio work in Dallas, and I was doing weekends with Doc Severinsen, and something was mentioned about Dixieland, and I didn't have any Dixieland experience at all, but there was a guy named Tommy Loy, and he had something to do with the Dallas Cowboys, but he had a Dixieland play every Monday night. I found Tommy Loy. Of course, he knew I was a studio guy in town. I said, Tommy, if you ever want anybody for your Dixieland gig, I'd like to play it. And he didn't know that I didn't know anything about Dixieland, so he let me play it for a month. I played it every Sunday night for a month, and I got myself in that situation where I had to learn it. I'll tell you a horrible thing that happened to me. That's the best thing that ever happened to me. We don't have time here. Maybe the next time, but it was the best thing that ever happened. I got my butt kicked royally, and that's what changed my life.
Okay. Excuse me, Paul, but back to this, just to finish up this electronic part, this is Bobby A. in Albany, New York.
Yeah.
He had noticed the Yamaha DTX Multi-12 by the hi-hat.
Yeah.
And you've already talked about how you use electronic percussion in the Nashville scene today, but he says, do you recommend also knowing how to program beats and all that? And I assume you do.
Yeah, you do. I don't do a lot of that. Most of the stuff we do now, I used to program every kick drum, every snare drum, every fill and everything, but that takes hours and hours. It really does. In studio, you don't have time for that. Now everything has gotten to be faster, quicker. Can you build me a loop? Yes, I can make a loop. So I tell you what, do I have time to do this or not?
Yes.
Okay, so on the multi 12, the great thing about the multi 12, and I'll just show a couple examples. You can go to, I've got a built-in program that's it's called Hand Conga. Can they hear this? So I can, it can be congas, and I can loop that into here, or I can go down to a drum set, and I can. Now I programmed that earlier, something very similar to that, in case we didn't have time and had to go fast, which we are. So here's the program. So I did that in about 10 seconds before we started our whole thing here. The point is, it can be that, and then that might be the opening part of the song. In this instant, I put the snare drum opposite of what that snare drum's doing intentionally. But the point is, you can build all kinds of things with this. I'm using they don't make this anymore. For a sequencer, I'm using the old Workstation 7000 Yamaha. The learning curve on that baby is pretty tough, but it feels really good. It's got high resolution, and so I use that. But if I was to want to, you know, go back to my conga program, I can quickly get to that. I can do by hand. Now, guess what that is? That's the other program playing through the conga. That's pretty cool too. That was a happy accident. That's a happy accident. That's the same MIDI notes from the other program that I did playing the percussion on this one. So it's actually pretty cool. We call that a happy accident. But what I was trying to do is I want to mute channel 10, and I'm going to choose channel 11, and I'm going to record, hopefully, something here. 2 and 1, 2, ready, go. Now, if you were to try to program that on a keyboard and make it sound anywhere near that natural, it would take a while. But and what did that take? Just to do a loop? Somebody says do a loop. Lucy, I'm home from the studio. Thank you. With the multi-12 and a good sequencer, you can get to a lot of things really quickly, quick and dirty.
Okay, Paul, I'm going to give you a couple of shout-outs here, and then we have time for one more question. Then I think you've got another track or two to play,
yeah.
Right? All right. Jada Holmes says, love your setup, Mr. Leim. Dave Zygmunt says, hi, from South Central Pennsylvania. John Lee says, howdy, from Austin, Texas.
Oh, great.
And Mario says, hello, from Italy.
Mario.
We had some Italians in this week, and they said it was Italy.
Italy.
We call it Italy. And they said it's Italy.
We right, love
and the
Italy.
Question is, and
we'll
I can't
be in, by the way, I'll be in Milano. Again, I'll put it on the website. I'll be in Milano second week of January. Look for the TCB band in Milano. We'll be in Milano. I don't know where you're at. Italy's a big place.
This is from someone in Poland, and their name is M-A-C-I-E-J. I'll let you pronounce that. But it says, hi, Paul, I have a question for you. What they're asking is, what did you practice your study, your exercise in the past, and do you have a weekly exercise plan? Is there a favorite thing you, say, warm up with or just keep your chops together with?
If I'm going to be doing believe it or not, I didn't play on any Michael Jackson records, but if I'm going to be doing a more pop project, I'll try to get my head more in that direction. I'll get out a Michael Jackson greatest hits record, and I'll try to play, and I'll play along with that to kind of get my head in that direction. If I'm going to be doing the Elvis show for a tour, or for one big night like this, the night of the 35th anniversary of his passing, and do this, I'll literally get out the DVDs of the show and run the show down. Speaking of that, I don't have time to go into how we do that show, but I'll rehearse something for a specific project. The Brian Setzer thing that I did earlier, Brian was worried about being able to get guys that knew how to play big band. This also happened when Ronnie Millsap wanted to go to Los Angeles and do a big band record. He said, I want to bring Paul Leim and Dave Hungate from Nashville. He said, I want to bring my studio players from Nashville. And the contractor, Jules Chaikin, who I used to work with at Disney, he said, well, you know, Nashville player, well, these charts are going to be all written out. You know, I don't know if you ought to, you know, all these charts are going to be written out here. I mean, we got some of the best writers in the world writing these things. He said, well, I'm bringing Paul Leim and Dave Hungate. Will that be okay? And he went, oh, my God, they used to be our first calls. Yeah, bring them up. Bring them. We can't wait to see them. So that's once again, being able to cover being ready for anything. I'm old. What was the question again?
Well, I think what you're saying and what I hear you saying is talking about how they prepare. You know, you might have to learn your paradiddles, but it's what's in your mind.
Yeah, but back to that. When we were getting ready for Ronnie Millsap's big band record, I got out a bunch of big band charts and played those for two or three days to get my head in that direction. I prepare for a project kind of like an actor prepares for a part, because it really is casting. When you're doing a record, when I produce all the time, and when I produce records or I'm a leader on sessions and I put projects together, I cast the project. I normally call Brent Mason, one of the finest guitar players in the world, if it's anything rock, country, that kind of thing. But if it's going to be screaming rock, I mean, we might go to Pat Buchanan or Kenny Greenberg. If it's a beautiful acoustic thing, it might be Steve Gibson. It might be Biff Watson. You know what I'm saying? We have people, you cast. I get cast on records. They used to call me because I was the big ballad, fugu, kigo, gugu, all that stuff. All the triplet-esque Lionel Richie fills. I used to get called because they thought I was a ballad guy. And I'm kind of I don't know what I am.
Well, thanks so much, Paul. Hey, we've enjoyed it today. We'd love to hear you play a few more tracks if you have them.
This has been a hoot. I've got a couple more things. These are some fun things that we do. Every year we do a radio package for Bob Kingsley's American Country Countdown. It's the biggest, it used to be called American Country Countdown. Now it's called Bob Kingsley's Country Top 40. And as They used to be on the, I don't know if you've seen the Modern Drummer Festival from 2000, where I did this thing with brushes. That was one of those from then that we took the track, pulled the drums off, and I played with it. This will be kind of an example of how country music has changed in the last 10 years. This is a couple of the play-ons from the same show, but just 10 years later. This will be interesting how the genre has changed in country music. Okay, we're almost done here. So let me, I've got to get my computer going again. Got to get these going. Anyway, thank you for having me.
Thank you, Paul Leim.
For this, the symbol is bigger than all of us.
I think the drums have somehow hogged a lot of the name credit. We're as much or more cymbal players than we are drummers.
I'm a cymbal freak, I'm a cymbalholic, if there's such a word. That's quite neat, isn't it, cymbalholic?
Cymbals are arguably the most personal part of your setup.
When you're buying your cymbals, you're buying something that you can't change. With drums, you can do a lot of things. You can tune him, you can muffle him, you know. With cymbals, you can't, you basically, that's what you have, you know.
The cymbals are your color instruments.
The cymbal is really the instrument that carries the rhythm. You know, the subdivisions are really there.
You could do a blindfold test of Art Blakey, Elvin Jones, Max Roach, Philly Joe Jones, Papa Joe Jones, Sid Catlett, whoever you want to put up there. Their ride cymbal was their calling card. You could identify the drummer from their ride cymbal sound.
That's why you see, you know, John Riley, for example, rolled in yesterday with his cymbal bag. He wanted to have his own cymbals.
Most of your business is on that cymbal. So that kind of becomes a signature of your sound.
Drums, first name, cymbals, last name.
MySymbol.com is a fantastic idea.
MySymbol.com is probably one of the most innovative websites that's out there today.
The new way for consumers to purchase product.
I think that's the way it should be done, really. It's amazing.
You actually get a really unique experience.
A new and different way to buy cymbals.
It's the type of information that you want to get from a retail store when you walk in the door and talk with a guy one-on-one. He's got it online, so that and you can get it 24 hours a day. It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
A drummer can virtually go without getting out of his pajamas and check it out online.
It allows the customer or potential customer to actually hear and see the cymbal they're buying without having to travel miles and miles and miles to the store and try it out there.
It's an incredible tool for a drummer to be able to go on a website and actually hear the cymbal that they're going to buy. I mean, actually the actual cymbal.
You buy that exact cymbal. You hear it played and you can buy that exact cymbal.
The cymbal that's played is the one that you purchase.
Well, every cymbal has a serial number appointed to it. So it's not that you like a 21-inch raw bell dry rod, you're going to get the first one out of the box. You're going to get the one that you heard online because of the way they set everything up.
To actually hear what a cymbal sounds like and you get exactly that cymbal that that guy played, that's amazing. It's great.
MySymbol.com takes a lot of the guesswork out of it.
By filming each model, by filming each unit individually, they're really helping drummers make a confident decision about buying a cymbal online, which is typically a risky business.
The risk is taken out of it because you're actually hearing people play the cymbal beforehand. And the people that he's got playing the cymbals know how to play the cymbals they're playing.
The cymbals are played by the professional players, first of all. And we are recommending good cymbals. It's not just to sell a cymbal or anything like that. It's really recommending a good sounding cymbal.
When Stanton Moore comes to town, he puts them to work, playing the cymbals, and that's the cymbal you'll buy.
They get to hear the cymbal played by a professional or by somebody who really knows how to pull out the very specific and individual sounds of that cymbal, or possibly play in a style that reflects the design of the cymbal, and really hear the cymbal in under the best possible circumstances, you know, well recorded.
And with the quality of digital sound and recording now, man, you know, it's the next thing to be in there. This kind of thing should have been going on 20 years ago.
This is the 21st century. I'm finally appreciating that there are some people that have realized that it is the 21st century.
There is no other drum retail outlet online that is doing what they are doing as far as bringing the cymbals to the forefront.
To my knowledge, he has everything that everybody makes. You're never going to find that kind of selection offline. And not only does he have sound files, which other people have done, he has video files, high def video and audio. You can do everything but touch the cymbal.
Can't get any better in terms of finding the breadth of selection to choose a cymbal that would define your voice.
Where there's this awesome selection of cymbals, second to none.
And the choice that they have here is exquisite.
So if you're a drummer and you can't find what you want, check out my symbol. It's very cool.
MySymbol.com. See you there.
My father said, you know, more than once, you know, remember this, the symbol is bigger than all of us.
I think the drums have somehow hogged a lot of the name credit. We're as much or more cymbal players than we are drummers.
I'm a cymbal freak. I'm a cymbalholic, if there's such a word. It's quite neat, isn't it? Cymbalholic.
Cymbals are arguably the most personal part of your setup.
When you're buying your cymbals, you're buying something that you can't change.
With drums, you can do a lot of things. You can tune them, you can muffle them, you know. With cymbals, you can't, you basically, that's what you have, you know.
The cymbals are your color instruments.
The cymbal is really the instrument that carries the rhythm. You know, the subdivisions are really there.
You could do a blindfold test of Art Blakey, Elvin Jones, Max Roach, Philly Joe Jones, Papa Joe Jones, Sid Catlett, whoever you want to put up there. Their ride cymbal was their calling card. You could identify the drummer from their ride cymbal sound.
That's why you see, you know, John Riley, for example, rolled in yesterday with his cymbal bag. He wanted to have his own cymbals.
Most of your business is on that cymbal. So that kind of becomes a signature of your sound.
Drums. First name, cymbals, last name.
MySymbol.com is a fantastic idea.
MySymbol.com is probably one of the most innovative websites that's out there today.
The new way for consumers to purchase product.
I think that's the way it should be done, really. It's amazing.
You actually get a really unique experience.
A new and different way to buy cymbals.
It's the type of information that you want to get from a retail store when you walk in the door and talk with a guy one-on-one. And he's got it online, so that and you can get it 24 hours a day. It's brilliant. It's brilliant.
A drummer can virtually go without getting out of his pajamas and check it out online.
It allows the customer or a potential customer to actually hear and see the cymbal they're buying without having to travel miles and miles and miles to the store and try it out there.
It's an incredible tool for a drummer to be able to go on a website and actually hear the cymbal that they're going to buy. I mean, actually the actual cymbal.
You buy that exact cymbal. You hear it played and you can buy that exact cymbal.
The cymbal that's played is the one that you purchase.
Well, every cymbal has a serial number appointed to it. So it's not that you like a 21-inch raw bell dry ride, you're going to get the first one out of the box. You're going to get the one that you heard online because of the way they set everything up.
To actually hear what a cymbal sounds like and you get exactly that cymbal that that guy played, that's amazing. It's great.
MySymbol.com takes a lot of the guesswork out of it.
By filming each model, by filming each unit individually, they're really helping drummers make a confident decision about buying a cymbal online, which is typically a risky business.
The risk is taken out of it because you're actually hearing people play the cymbal beforehand. And the people that he's got playing the cymbals know how to play the cymbals they're playing.
The cymbals are played by the professional players, first of all, and we are recommending good cymbals. It's not just to sell a cymbal or anything like that. It's really recommending a good sounding cymbal.
When Stanton Moore comes to town, he puts them to work playing the cymbals, and that's the cymbal you'll buy.
They get to hear the cymbal played by a professional or by somebody who really knows how to pull out the very specific and individual sounds of that cymbal, or possibly play in a style that reflects the design of the cymbal, and really hear the cymbal in under the best possible circumstances, you know, well recorded.
And with the quality of digital sound and recording now, man, you know, it's the next thing to be in there.
this should, kind of thing should have been going on 20 years ago.
This is the 21st century. I'm finally appreciating that there are some people that have realized that, that it is the 21st century.
There is no other drum retail outlet online that is doing what they are doing as far as bringing the cymbals to the forefront.
To my knowledge, he has everything that everybody makes. You're never going to find that kind of selection offline. And not only does he have sound files, which other people have done, he has video files, high def video and audio. You can do everything but touch the cymbal.
Can't get any better in terms of finding the breadth of selection to choose a cymbal that would define your voice.
Where there's this awesome selection of cymbals, second to none.
And the choice that they have here is exquisite.
So if you're a drummer and you can't find what you want, check out my cymbal. It's very cool.
MyCymbal.com. See you there.